Let's make the future. Let's make the future. Let's make the future. Let's make the future. Welcome to Let's Make the Future, a discussion about future trends, technologies, and their implications for human society. We are coming to you from all over the world, featuring the voices of Michael Curry, Giuseppe Romano, Michael Oloranimwo.
Welcome to Let's Make the Future. I'm Michael Curry, and this week we have a special guest, Sondre Rach. Actually, Sondre, why don't you tell me how you pronounce your name?
Well, I'm Norwegian, and in Norwegian that name is pronounced Rask.
Oh.
But your pronunciation was interesting, so we can go with that.
Let's just call you Sondre and avoid that problem. So we also have a usual cast of panelists this week here to ask Sondre some interesting questions. So why don't you introduce yourselves?
I'm Giuseppe. I'm a native Italian, and I do research on computational science. I look for materials that can convert heat into electricity. By doing that, I had to work with models and simulations, and sometimes I hope I can extend those models to the origin of life and beyond.
Hi, my name is Michael. I'm a consultant. I'm working in Nigeria for a number of years, and just concluded a master's degree at Stanford University. So I'm currently exploring the blockchain technology, you know, to provide solutions to scale some typical, like, say, to scale some solutions to people who are at the bottom 2 billion of the world population. So that's me.
So as usual, we have a cast of characters all interested in making the future and attacking it from different perspectives. And now our guest this week is taking a wholly different perspective and is going to lead us into a discussion here today. So Sondre is a 30-year-old Norwegian, and he has a background in economics and computer science. He founded the freelance platform Consus, which was in Y Combinator, and SafetyNet, SafetyWing. Maybe he can tell us about this at some point. Sounds interesting. And he was also formerly policy advisor for the Parliament of Norway. So take it away, Sondre.
Thank you, Michael. Great intro. So the topic that I wanted to talk about today is the fundamental problem that I suppose we all face, which is how to think about what to do next, or phrased a bit more cliche-like, which causes to work on in our lives. And since I was young, I found this an interesting topic. So I should say that the inspiration for my research into this topic comes to a large degree from what some call the rationality community. In the late 90s and early 2000s, there was some rationality community called Less Wrong, which has later spurred some interesting subcommunities like effective altruism. And what this community tries to think about are questions of this magnitude, sort of the big questions, but to structure them in a way that makes sense and is applicable, and where you use all the available knowledge to maximize your impact in life and the effectiveness of that endeavor. So today, the way I've structured my little intro and just ask questions as we go is that I will first present three reasons for why it is worthwhile to think about what to do next. And then I'll go through seven relevant ideas, sort of component ideas that I think are important to have in mind when doing this exercise. And lastly, I'll just give my personal conclusions, like how do I use this knowledge to my own decisions in life, and how have I done that?
So Sondre, that makes sense, and that plan of attack seems great. I'm wondering, when you say what to do next, are you referring to the very practical decision-making that we have to do every day in our lives? Like if I'm walking down the street and I'm deciding whether I want to go to work or go to the gym or do something else, this is what you're referring to? Or are you thinking about on a societal level? What's the scope here?
One point I will get back to is I think that these are different variations of the same question in a way. It just depends on where you... It's more a question of derivation, whether to look at an individual or a point in time. But I definitely do think that what you do in a given day is connected to what you think society should be doing and what you think is the most valuable thing to spend your time on over long periods of time. So yeah.
Makes sense.
It's the big question of the whole society and your whole life. But I do think that in practice, this turns out to more an input in what to do with which actions to take in a given day. So that's how I view that.
All right. That makes sense. Go right ahead. Yeah. Great, thanks.
Yeah, okay. So the reason I wanted to start with why I think about this at all is that one of the things that motivated me originally to start thinking about this maybe 16 years ago is a realization that I could have more effect than I assumed. So there are some memes that are very common in society currently, which I think are a bit confusing to people. For example, there is the meme of whether we, let's say, make any difference given that the universe is infinitely large, and whether a single person can make a difference given that there are 7 billion people on the earth, etc. So I just wanted to address a few of these questions, which I think are actually fallacious. So the first is the problem of whether you are just one person, how can you possibly make a difference given that there are 7 billion people on the earth. And I think that that's actually a wrong way to model humanity, especially now with the internet. So the right way, I think, to model the human project is as a network. And that means that any person is a node in a network. And given that you have 1,000 friends and they maybe have 1,000 friends over a lifetime, then you are once removed from 1 million and 2 people removed from 1 billion people. And when looking at how information propagates in a network, you can see that each individual person has the potential to affect a large part of the world very quickly. The second problem is the problem of that sort of Stephen Hawking mentions in his book, A Brief History of Time, which is that we are chemical scum on a typical Earth, on a mediocre planet, around a mediocre star, around a mediocre galaxy. And sort of the problem of mediocrity is what they call it. And I think that this is a misunderstanding because a typical point in space is basically interstellar space. So even though this is true, there is nothing typical about our specific position in space and time. And furthermore, connected to this is the question of what is possible in our future. And this book, The Beginning of Infinity, since I think lays out incredibly persuasively, I realize this is a big topic to take in this brief intro. But essentially, the conclusion from that book is that as long as things are within the laws of physics, then all problems are soluble in a way, which leaves open an infinite avenue for future possibilities. And I think that this is also an axiom that I'm building this further talk on. Okay, and the third point, which is connected to this, is the reference frame. So one reason that people would say that it doesn't matter what they do is that they have a, from my point of view, a wrong reference frame. So a reference frame is like a person standing on a train and the train is moving from left to right, but the person is moving backwards, right? So which reference frame is correct to analyze the boy standing in the train? And I think this question of reference frame often comes up where people say that, let's say, we doesn't matter because the universe is infinitely big, for example. But I think that that is just an error of using the wrong reference frame. So the correct reference frame to use is one of the appropriate scale and effect of the sort of world that we inhabit. And the reason this is the correct one is that there is, as we know, even if we say we can't discriminate between reference frames, there is one that is relevant only to us, and that is our local reference frame. And in that reference frame, our action makes all the difference. So those are three axioms. Did all of that make sense to you guys? I mean, those are some big ideas, but I wanted to lay some groundwork there.
So are you going to expand on each of those points now, or?
I'm not, yeah. Because I'm going to have a dense talk, you could say. But so no, let's do some Q&A before we move on those.
Actually, Sondre, could you summarize in one word or two words each of the 1, 2, 3?
So 1, you're a node in a network. 2, this is an atypical point in space and time. And 3, the right reference frame is a local reference frame.
So it strikes me that this is sort of a humanistic manifesto, that the correct way to look at the world is not with a god or not anything other than to care about fellow humans. Would you agree?
No, not necessarily. I think that I did not include personally anything related to that. The way I think about questions of God and the infinite is that that's a very valid endeavor that I basically think is dealing with the problem of the infinite and evolutionally attained knowledge. So we are bounded creatures in a way, and we have limited computation power and memory. So when acting in the world, we are dealing with more information than we can possibly have in our brain at a single time, even though we can explain it, which means that we will always be contending with, as you can say, things we don't know. And to me, it seems that religions is like narrative form ways of trying to solve that problem. So I don't exclude that a priori at all. I think that that's a valid source of evolutionarily attained knowledge. I say evolutionarily attained because it's different from an explanation. So in this presentation, I will go through things that I do understand, meaning explanations. The way I see religions is that it's evolutionarily attained knowledge, meaning that it's like why does spider better know how to build a web. It doesn't. It just knows that if it builds the web like this, it works. So I wouldn't rule out those things. I think that's valid. It's just since we don't have very good explanations for a lot of that, I don't include it in this consideration. But some of these ideas I should overlap with what you can find in old stories.
Okay, no, that makes sense. Does anyone have any other questions at this point before Sondre continues with his presentation? Okay, go right ahead, Sondre.
Okay, so I will now go through seven what I find to be relevant ideas, which are interesting in its own sake for choosing what to do next, given the axiom that it actually matters what you do. So the first idea is the Pareto distribution, which is that a few things make almost all the difference. So you're familiar, of course, with the normal distribution, which is like most things in the middle and everything entails out to each side around some kind of typical center. And some people, when they choose which actions to do, assume that the effect of an action is normal distributed. I certainly noticed that I did that myself, meaning that I would put in a lot of work and just do anything I could. And I think that this can lead to catastrophic mistakes because the effective actions to me seem to be Pareto distributed and not normal distributed. And that means that a few actions make almost all the difference. So this is a common meme understanding. It's a very relevant idea to thinking about what to do exactly, because that means that the act of thinking about which tasks to do, which actions to take, and doing those that are most impactful might be the most impactful thing you do, because it's clearly possible to do a lot of things that make almost no difference, and it's possible to do some things that make a big difference. So that's the first thing, that the effective actions are Pareto distributed. First idea. The second idea is that what meaning is, which is one of the articles sent out, is to maximize future meaningful moments. So it's a bit self-recursive, but meaning, as in the experience of meaning, what is meaningful? Something is meaningful to the degree that it leads to future situations where you can have meaningful moments. And what that means specifically is that some things you do are basically dead ends. It leads to one more thing and then it stops, while other things you do unleash a wide possibility of future options.
Right, and not just for you, but also for the future. So if you do something that Mark Zuckerberg did, man, that created a lot of meaningful moments, didn't it? So
it did, and it created a lot of meaningful moments for many people. And this sort of optionality, you could say, is a key idea in choosing what to do next, I think, especially because some actions you take are sort of, they cause things to roll on their own. So if you do something that is meaningful, then that is very likely to have a much higher effect than you can sort of even imagine from the action itself. So a very typical example is like having children, right? Or starting a company like Facebook. Just the act itself yields some immediate consequences. But because it is a meaning that is central with many open branches, then the future effects are much larger. It's sort of impossible to even comprehend what can happen from, let's say, starting Facebook. I'm sure Mike Zuckerberg never considered the possibility that it would have like 2 billion members on it, and certainly a parent can't know what a child will do with their life, etc.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
third, go ahead.
So can we in one sentence summarize this in a way that, so by saying that an action, a meaningful action, is what maximizes long-term reward, but also what maximizes the uncertainness, the fact that we don't know, it's like creating a creature about which we lose control.
Yeah, you could say that. I would also say that it's complex optimization, a recursive complex optimization across time and scale. So scale is the people. So you can say that here's the optimization problem. What's the optimal thing to do both for you and your friends and the world, both now and in the future? So that's the optimization. And a way to simplify how to think about that is to do things that is what we call meaningful. And meaning is, I think it's an approximation on this underlying problem, which is essentially that you maximize meaningful moments in the future. And yeah, each of those are uncertain and high variance, as you described, but it's not variance for its own sake. It's positive value. That comes back to a later slide. But
okay.
Yes, it's uncertainty.
Okay. Great.
Okay, I'll continue. The third idea is, the next two slides is connected to brain. So the third idea is that perception is coupled to goal and goal attainment. So there is this field called perceptual psychology. There is a researcher there called Jacob Gibson, and he has done a lot of, which is now famous, experiments to discover how we view perception today. So perception is what you see, essentially, what you notice in your environment. So a quote from his paper is that what we see in our environment is not objects, but the perceived utility of objects. Everything with zero perceived utility becomes invisible, as demonstrated in our experiments. So what that means is that as you navigate the world, as you look out in the room now that you're in, it seems like you're seeing the objects that are there objectively. And what these experiments have shown is that things that don't have any perceived value, let's say that a pattern on the carpet or the shapes in nearby furniture, would not be something you would remember if you weren't specifically paying attention to it. And the reason is that brain see it as of low utility, while what you do see is things that you can use, like chairs to sit in, table to put the things in, etc., shoes to put your feet in. And what he has shown through his experiments is that this is malleable, it's plastic. So when you set a certain goal, then what you see is things that help you attain that goal. Okay, so that means that perceptions seem to be very closely linked to goal and goal attainment. Another thing that's been shown, which is closely related to this, is the brain's reward system. Motivational circuits also seem to be related to goal and goal attainment, meaning that what makes you quote-unquote happy, as in release of dopamine and serotonin in the brain, is not achieving a goal, but it's doing things that work towards a goal. And both of these fundamental insights, which I think is one of the few things we know from psychology, really, and experimental psychology, is that for your brain to work in a way, it really matters what you set as your goal and the path there. So that's idea number three. Now we'll go on to idea number four. Idea number four, which is related to idea number three, is that the appropriate way to look at the brain is not as a uniform entity, but as a collective of different psychological centers with varying motivations that won't necessarily be coordinated on its own. So this comes from personality research, essentially, where you find that certain centers in the brain act almost as separate, let's say, personalities that have different desires, and that there are parts of the brain that coordinate this, but that one part of being effective is to simply coordinate your own brain in a way. And there are three examples I want to put forward, mention briefly, for how to do this. One is to have a goal and write it down. It's a way to align different parts of the brain, specifically to align the sort of language center with the visual part of the cortex, which is the biggest part of the brain. The second is attention. So we don't completely know the effect of attention, but we do know that it is a sorting and coordinating mechanism, so that whatever you pay attention to, you sort of sort out in the brain and integrate different parts of the brain. And there are also some speculative theories, which I think hold credibility, that attention also seems to reduce entropy wherever you look for some reason. And the third example is lying. So part of the, in addition to setting goals and doing goal attainment, part of the way you're able to navigate in the world is through accurate signals. So when you say something that's a lie, you're essentially corrupting your own signals a bit, because part of your brain believes it. And this is also shown to be the fact in multiple experiments where people, for example, there was one experiment where they said they had done a task, even though they were just instructed to say it, and shown that they had considerably less motivation to do that task later. This was graduate students. And what this sort of shown is that basically a part of the motivational center in the brain more or less believed that task was already complete. So it believed its own lie. So that's that idea. Now, idea number five is upgrading your utilitarianism. So in choosing what to work on, like if you have in mind the idea of doing meaningful things, then you want to do positive, meaningful things. And one of the best ways I've found so far to think about this is utilitarianism, meaning the most good for the most possible people. Or you could say one variant of utilitarianism is reducing suffering, which is sort of the inverse of that, but it's the same idea. One thing that I found that helped me a lot in thinking more clearly and when using utilitarianism to choosing what to do is to put some kind of weight on people in the future and other people than you. So there should probably be some kind of discounting, but by putting some value on people in the future and people other than you, it seems to me that you adapt more correctly. So you want to reduce suffering both today and in the future, and you want to reduce suffering both with you and across people simultaneously for optimal adaptation. So if you can imagine like the meaning thing as doing things that is, like you said, high variance, then you want to sort of weight those actions, the things that is high variance, tilted towards the good. And what is that good? Well, this is a good contender. the one that I find most persuasive.
I like to do that when I am telling myself to document code. I say, well, I might not need to do it now, but if I put some weight onto the people that are going to have to look at this in the future, some of those people might be me. And so, yes, I should document today.
Yeah, that's definitely a little altruistic motivation right there. Okay, and now the last idea that I want to consider is a problem that I faced, and I think a lot of people face when trying to figure out, let's say, big questions like what to do or purpose, beliefs, is that they can seem impossible or intractable because the problems are so large and there's so much to take account of. So how do you move forward? And this idea is an idea from computer science, and that is one method for solving intractable problems is relaxation, meaning what if you remove a constraint? You impose a constraint on the problem you're solving in order to make a qualified guess. You can also then make multiple guesses on the different constraints and see if there is any overlap. So two use cases where this is relevant in your own sort of private software is one, when calibrating your own beliefs. So it seems to me, I'm not certain of this, but one, it seems to me that beliefs may be a form of constraints in its fundamentally, meaning that beliefs are sort of axioms, assumptions that we believe to be true and which we use to constrain problems we consider. So because we assume that whatever those beliefs were based on, the knowledge tree that they were based on is valid. So calibrating your own beliefs then becomes incredibly important to calibrate the constraints you will impose on any situation. So the second use case is choosing, let's say, a purpose for yourself. So by using constraints to make a guess, you can come at an answer very quickly. If you leave all doors open, the computation required to solve the problem is sort of close to infinite, and you'll be like just thinking your whole life and never get to the conclusion. But, you know, that has many detrimental effects. You know, see the previous ideas. So what you instead, well, what we found in computer science is the way to solve this problem is by imposing constraints and then just going with thinking a little bit and then going with your best guess, while of course being open to modifying, improving that belief in the future. So examples could be the sort of cliche ones, where it might be, you know, what would you do if you had 6 months to live? What would you do if you had $1 billion? So these are examples of constraints that make it easier to come up with things. And then you can contrast and compare your answers across constraints. Maybe it's to see if you get something. So one PS when it comes to doing these things like calibrating beliefs, choosing a purpose, is that it seems to me that one of the key parts, the way the brain have solved this, is by processes and not definite answers. So while it is helpful and you kind of have to choose beliefs, choose a purpose, the way it seems to me that the optimal way to navigate going forward is to have this pattern of continuous improvement, so that what you're aiming for is really not a specific belief or specific purpose fundamentally, but it's you're aiming for the highest possible good and the most true thing, so that you have this meta pattern process going in the background that allows you to update beliefs and purpose as you encounter evidence. Right. So that was the ideas that I built this on. And now I can mention briefly my own conclusions from this. And then I'd love to get your criticism on.
Actually, I wonder if it would be okay, Sondre, if we could just ask you questions right now, unless you think it makes far more sense for you to give your conclusions.
Yeah, ask some questions right now.
So I just want to make some space for Haas, Giuseppe, and Michael to ask some questions now, if they happen to have some.
Yeah, I had a question about the third question, actually, that you laid down at the beginning about the reference frame. So how do those ideas relate to that question?
So the reference frame is, okay, so specifically, if you think about the problem of perception and setting a constraint, so both of those are actually reference frame solutions. It's like applied reference frame. So when thinking about what to do, you're not operating in an unbounded space. You're operating in a very constrained space, which is that you inhabit a point in space, time, and you have certain capabilities, like you have a body and a brain and a context. And you could structure that and say that that is your relevant reference frame, right? And when applying a reference frame to everyday life, that is essentially the problem of perception. What is relevant? Which space sort of am I operating in? And it seems to me that the space that you're operating in is kind of evolutionary space, which is where what you're looking for is utility towards a certain goal, and the constraints that you put in is what is relevant to your situation. So it doesn't make any sense to talk about what should be done with Alpha Centauri. It's a star system far away. You can't do anything about it. So it's not a relevant reference frame. So we do this all the time. We do constrain a reference frame, I find, continuously anyway, but people aren't aware that they're doing it. They sort of just think that that's, of course, it doesn't make sense. And the reason is that, yes, it doesn't make sense to use different reference frames. The reason I mention it specifically is that often when people talk about these questions, they invoke irrelevant reference frames. I've just found that to be the case in conversations. Like people would say, yeah, but that doesn't really matter because the universe is huge, right? Or what do I matter? I'm just one person. And that to me seems to be just an example of using an irrelevant reference frame that we don't do. Otherwise, we don't do it in everyday life. That would be impossible to operate.
I suppose anything that you don't have agency over would be, in a sense, an irrelevant reference frame. And so you might want to always constrain any problem that you have. If you're trying to decide what action to take, you certainly want to constrain the problem in the sense of thinking of it as only being in the frame of reference that matters to, you know, the things that you can do with your body and walking around the world and making actions.
Yeah, I think that's a great way to do it, I think, in everyday life. When having a long period of time, I think you can increase it somewhat because your effects can have effects.
Fair enough, yeah.
Yeah.
That makes sense. Any other questions, or maybe I should say any other comments or observations right now?
Yeah, so I just wanted to chip in on the concept of meaning and the meaningful actions. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that sometimes it's difficult to understand the impact or the consequentiality of an action at the moment when you take them. Maybe sometimes you are able to see, you know, or understand how consequential an action is in retrospect more. But I kind of like also want to just highlight that usually like meaningful moments in the future are usually made up of series of meaningful actions taken in the past. You know, so it's not just one action that leads to a very big consequential outcome in the future. So you have to just like, so which means that even when you fail to take a consequential action today, you can always course correct, you know, like, and just follow up with strong meaningful actions in the future. So that would help you to course correct and to be able to like evolve into that meaningful future that we all want to have. And I kind of like also agree with the concept of having, thinking of decisions in the context of maybe if you have a family or if you have want to have some certain impact on the world, it kind of also helps you to put your decision into context, right? So if we were to look at life from the non-altruistic point of view, I think the concept of meaning might not be as strong as we want it to be or as we would think it is.
Mm. Yeah, that's two interesting points there. And so to take the first one, that it's a difficult calculation in a way. It's hard to know. I think that's certainly is true. And that said, I do think that sometimes we can identify obviously meaningless tasks. So it seems to me that this problem is something that the brain already has good functions for. I actually haven't read that as much research on this. I've heard one lecture on how the brain calibrates meaning, but it seems to be basically this way. And so that means that what I've found is that when you're calibrating correctly, meaning that you have aligned yourself towards a goal, you can sort of use basically the signal so that something feels meaningful as a signal that you're going the right way. It's like it's a conscious signal where that complex calculation is solved in the background. And certainly we know that when something feels completely meaningless, we're usually able to identify that. Like if you went out today and just dig and fill the hole back again, I think after not long, you might sort of get this feeling that this is completely pointless. And how do you end up at that realization? I think that that's basically the kind of calculation we're talking about here done by the brain. So that's one, I think, practical use. The other one is to, at least for the big questions. So if you find things that through reasoning you find to have high meaning, so this comes back to one of my conclusions, like let's say space colonization, which seems to me to be a very high meaningful activity, given all the possibility that might possibly spawn of humanity in space. You can then, through logic, find that some things have very high meaning and then sort of put that in the category of belief thereafter, right? So I don't think you need to figure it out every time. You can think about it consciously on some big strategies, and then you can rely on the basically emotion in everyday life, the feeling of meaning.
Makes sense.
That's a hypothesis.
So Sondre, you've given us a tantalizing collection of tools to hack our brains into choosing what to do, which was the original problem you put to us. But I'm wondering if there are some contradictions in those tools. In particular, I wonder if the number two tool, which was meaning to maximize future meaningful moments, kind of an evolutionary approach, the idea of evolving. Like I think of Lean Startup also has kind of the same concept where you iterate towards a solution without necessarily knowing the final plan right away. And I guess I wonder how that reconciles with some of the other tools that you proposed having to do with having a final end goal, because evolution doesn't have a goal in mind. Having a goal would even be a negative thing because it would prejudice the winnowing process. And I wonder if purely engaging in a series of iterative local maximization steps might be more true to the philosophy that you're bringing up here. And having a grand goal at the end of things might be actually wholly inappropriate.
That's a great critique. And that is certainly true that those two things are on the surface in conflict. I find them to be reconcilable in the following way. So when trying things, let's say experimenting, let's say in a startup, how do you choose what to try? And what I found in my own startup life is that the things you can try are actually close to infinite, but each test is costly. That's the thing that I found. So in choosing what to try, I find that trying in a certain direction is a way to constrain your experiments, which you have to do anyway. You have to constrain your experiments because you can't do infinite experiments because there's a cost constraint to experimenting. And if you think about it, like just in daily life, that also makes total sense. Like if you arrive at a door and there's no knob on the door, you don't know how to open the door, but you want to get through the door. And you can see then these two principles operating in the situation. Go get through the door. But then again, you don't want to, you want to be listened to the results of your small experiments of getting the door open, like push on one side, you know, feel around for a knob, push on the bottom, push on the top, try to pull it towards you. So there are a bunch of things you can try. And what sort of becomes quickly insane if you don't listen to the results of your experiments. So you try one thing and then you try the same thing over and over again, even though it doesn't work. Another thing, these things are not really in conflict, right? Because obviously you can also do an infinite number of other things in that situation, right? You could pick your nose, you could eat an apple. None of those things will help you get through the door. But if you don't have the goal of going through the door, what you try becomes random. So yeah, it may work, but in what direction? So you have to constrain it anyway. And by constraining it towards a goal, you can still do in everyday life sort of operate towards complete experimentation and testing. So another example, like if you're in a startup and you do customer interviews, right? I do this all the time. So you're in a startup and you do customer interviews. What do you listen to? So this other day, a friend made a joke. It was showing some features to a user or friend, and he gave some various feedback. And this, of course, was a platform, a technology platform. And one of his feedback was that, he's actually kind of hungry. Do we sell hamburgers? And that's a user feedback. And why don't I listen to that? What makes that feedback less relevant? Well, of course, you could say maybe other people aren't giving the same feedback, but I think the reason you could a priori just dismiss that feedback is that because it's not in the direction that you're going. And even when you constrain, you find that you have almost infinite, like you still have huge variety of things to test. So that's how I reconcile these two ideas. Having a goal is going in a direction. It's a way to constrain what you experiment, but by being evolutionary within that approach, meaning thinking about what works and being wholly responsive to that. And this isn't to updating both your beliefs. And I think you can also update what you're going for on evidence. But I do think you need something to go for, even though you're open to updating it.
Okay, great. Thanks. I think about this collection of tools as almost an algorithm or something that could be potentially turned into a rather high-level algorithm that could be taught to a computer or programmed into an attempt at an artificial general intelligence. So I'm wondering if the way you're characterizing decision-making, you're turning it into something that can be made into a process, where I think in the past, there's a certain amount of mystique attached. There's the myth of the genius startup founder and the idea that they just know what's best and there's no process attached to it. It just seems to be a divine inspiration that they come up with these ideas and there it is. And I wonder if this takes some of the myth out of that and turns it into an algorithm. Because often the best executives, the best leaders follow a process, perhaps one resembling the one that you've described, rather than making decisions from their gut, like George W. Bush liked to say that he made his decisions from, right? Or maybe that was just a Stephen Colbert satirization of him. But nevertheless, there's two schools of thought, follow your gut or follow a process. And it definitely seems like decision making might be far more vulnerable to automation, to being turned into a process, than perhaps we imagine right now. Perhaps an executive is basically an assembly line worker, but just operating on a different level of abstraction.
I think that that's absolutely true. And actually some things I considered including in this thing, which I didn't, which I think is absolutely programmable when it comes to this, which is also a computer. It's an established computer science idea. So it's like you do a random generation, you generate a random solution in a direction, and you do sort of selective retaining based on some criteria. And this to me seems to approximate what we call creativity, which is, it actually comes back to your exact question, Michael, which is, what do you try? Well, if a sort of AI thing can try anything, then the problem becomes intractable. But if you narrow it, then you can do random, if you narrow it to be on something and have some selective retaining based on whether what is generated by the algorithm makes sense along some kind of rule, then you, I think you can make both creative computers and interesting decision-making computers. So yeah, I do think that we can certainly in the near future can imagine someone making supporting decision-making tools, decision creative machines that help you figure out what to do in a situation. And that, I think, is a hopeful one. One more note, though, on that thing about whether deconstructing this thing takes the myth out. I don't think it has to. So the way I think about myth is sort of the myth is of the founder who just knows, let's say, or a lot of things, other myths, is that myths is to some degree also just abstractions. That's at least how I think about it. So it's the same with beliefs. So it's useful to make abstractions. So for example, having the myth that someone is pure good, right, as a friend of yours, or a myth that someone just knows, is actually just, it's a way to operate so that you by default trust that person, for example. And whatever, when you're deconstructing something, it kind of feels like, oh, you're taking the myth out, taking the magic out. But you can still return to an abstraction, even knowing that there is a process behind the outcome, I think. So that was just a little comment on that it is possible. I think it's possible to reconcile. In everyday life, yeah, these two things are usually in conflict. But that is, in my view, just because people treat the myths as explanations instead of abstractions. And then it obviously becomes false in a way and disproven by seeing that there's a process to the madness.
That's a great observation. I've often been, I've heard that if you develop a reputation for being an early riser, then you can sleep in until noon every day. I think that's a quote from someone. Anyway, it seems like you can build up a myth for yourself and then relax what you actually do. Maybe that's another life hack you can add to your list there. Any other comments from anyone in the room before we wrap this up, guys?
I have one comment, which might turn into a couple of other comments too, but I would say I really liked your presentation because it's a manifestation of mathematics and computer science into the realm of philosophy and meaning of life, which is by itself creative and novel. So I enjoyed it a lot. And the concept that I took from your speech was the utility that you talked about, how the perception is basically based on the utility that we perceive. We can never be sure we perceive everything. I mean, the only thing we are sure is that we can never perceive everything. So, and I think the concept of infinity that we have in our brains is by itself only a manifestation of the idea that we don't know if there is a barrier. It's like the only thing we can be sure of is that we don't know. And that by itself is an infinite situation that we are in. So because we don't know if there is a barrier at the end of the universe or multiverse or whatever there is. And at the same time, we can't perceive what it means to be infinite. So that's my comment, that the only thing we can be sure of is like we just don't know. And I feel like that's a good meaningful thing to start with for the current human being. As you said, myth, people confuse myth with explanations and they consider them as explanation instead of an abstraction. But what I would say here is that we can never be sure that we are not doing the same mistake in the current time. Because I think anything that we come up with as the most meaningful and up-to-date explanation of today is still an abstraction. But the only thing which I always refer to, this interesting Indian belief that every person is a religion and the most true religion is the one that most people follow. So I think the only legitimate explanation of the human condition is the one that is most popular. So there is no other authority that based on that you can legitimize an explanation to the human condition. That's one comment I have here. And about the human brain, when you commented on human brain, I thought of a couple of things. One is the concept of consciousness that we hear a lot, that it's something specific to humans or maximum as animals, that they have some lower versions of it. But what I've seen in some other people discussing and what I believe myself is the consciousness is something that is, I mean, human brain is a medium that reflects and imprints the networks and information surrounding itself onto a different medium. So human brain is nothing but a response to the stimuli outside. And what happens on top of that, so let's say a stone is responding to its environment by defining, by having a crystal of some solid state material, which is rigid. But the only difference is that human brain is like a fluid kind of a soft material that when it responds to the environment, even though it forms some crystallized hard structure that holds some information in longer times, but at the same time, it has parts that are most volatile and it changes so quickly. So I would say there is no difference between a consciousness of a stone and a human brain other than complexity. So complexity is the only thing that we could grab as a distinguishing factor between different consciousness among different objects and creatures that we can perceive. And then my last comment would be the entropy here, because I feel it's wish we owe entropy to talk about it a little bit when we have we discussed these ideas when we talk about meaningful meaning in the meaning of life. So I think the latest we know about entropy is that it's expanding, it's increasing in the universe. So that's the latest. So
that's the latest update.
And that gives us, that's the religion, to be honest. That's the starting point of religion we can construct. That's the mythology we can base our meaning on. So for now, what we can say is the entropy is increasing, and that's why all the human endeavor is trying to expand any everything. It's like, what is sustainability? Sustainability is nothing but aiming eternity. Why do you want to keep doing what you're doing? Why do you want to do that? Why do you just, yeah, you did it great, just end it. Why? So we want eternity. Eternity is a form of like entropy. It's expansion in the opposite of inhibition. And we like to excite things. We like to repeat things. So I guess entropy, increasing entropy is a good start to see. I once tried to come up with a morality, like a cosmic morality. And the last thing I could come up with that a couple of examples was like, we don't like killing our own kind because we feel like a human being is more capable of increasing entropy in his lifetime more than by dying. So if you die, yeah, like you might increase the entropy by just expanding your molecules in the planet. But I think if a human being lives and the things he might accomplish is probably increases entropy more than, so increasing entropy could be a starting point, I feel, for thinking and entertaining ourselves with the meaning of life.
Perhaps we should introduce a legal system that makes it illegal to increase entropy more than is necessary.
Yeah, no, there are many interesting points there. Just one thing on the first one you said, which I think is a very good point, that this process, like how do you deal with things you don't know? And it seems to me that one very easy way is to run like a self-recursive, self-replicating process that is sort of ever improving, whatever you call it, aiming at perfection. And this is also, I think, why recent tech entrepreneurship is such a sort of good way to sort of good mode to operate in. You know, to be effective is that some of these things are built into how people do startups. Like it's a quick sort of iteration and being able to create something like a different life from scratch. Whereas, so I previously was like, is it tech entrepreneurship or politics that's the most effective? And I tried politics, tried policy. And one of the difficult things is changing existing systems. It's very difficult because it's not self-directed and it's not the pace of recursive self-improvement is not necessarily there. Plus you have, in politics, you have like ideologies which pop up, which have definite goals. And so I just want to mention that that process was one of the things that I reasoned that tech entrepreneurship is probably the best way to spend my time.
I must comment on what you just said about the recursive processes, because I read a research recently that based on some most successful novels in the history of literature, they have come up with this pattern that the successful storytelling is when it's circular. So it starts from one point, it takes you through a journey and brings you back. And it doesn't necessarily mean there has to be one single one. Like there is a large circle starting from the end, beginning of novel and then ending there. And also there are smaller journeys. So the periods of these circles are multiple of them and there is a larger one. And it had correlated with the human psychology, how like brain works and the way we live basically our lives is the way we have a home, for example, like we go out and we come back. So there's always a returning point. The way we sleep, we go out, we do multiple things and we come back. And then insecurity actually shows up when there's an uncertainty in returning. Because if you don't return, if you don't have a good ending, if you don't have, you don't expect, you don't foresee that you're going to get back to where you were, you're going to feel insecure and not enjoying your journey. And it's also another research shows how human brain only remembers the last part. So, for example, the reason women that go through a lot of pain with giving birth is that, for example, they do it once and it's horrible. It's painful. But at the end of it, they get rewarded mentally and psychologically. And next time when they think of it, they remember the last part. They remember at the end of it, it was good. So they think of the whole process as a good thing and they want to do it again. So it's like human brain only remembers the last part of every process. So if there's a good ending, we like the story. We always think of it as a good thing. Or if it was a bad ending. So this recursive processes that you mentioned reminded me of the whole human brain psychology, that we are bound to see the world as we are.
I think that's a very good observation. Stories does seem to be one of the main ways information is stored and produced in the brain, narrative form. And yeah, it's always like from A to B, and then on that path, various things happen and you do certain things to overcome it. So yeah, I do certainly see that a lot of things in life are recursive and a recursive self-improving pattern. But I do think that it's not all recursive things are equally good. The way I tend to think of it is that you could have a stagnant pattern, like basically copy paste, right? Just like copying something and then like pasting control V over and over again is, you know, in theory recursive, but it's not good because it goes in a strict circle. But what sort of I think is better is to have a circle that has the possibility of improving its own circle. So spreading out like some kind of infinite varied fractal instead of a copy paste loop. And that the difference between the two is just whether you're aiming for something specific or whether you're aiming for continuous improvement. That to me seemed to be the sort of core difference between ending up in either of those situations. So I think that's a great observation, and given that, but it matters which recurse you're running.
I like these comments on complexity, entropy, and the connection between them, and also recursion here. But we are past time, and I'd like to give Giuseppe a chance to reflect on things. Maybe he can have the last word or the second last word. If you would like to go ahead, Giuseppe, please go ahead.
I just want to comment on the sentence the host said about remembering only the last part of a movie. I really like that, and the fact is true. I would better generalize a little bit. Remember the first and the last. So I would say the last with respect to the first scene. And this can be modeled by a force system. There are certain forces that actually the potential of something is always, certain systems can be modeled by potential that just happen at the beginning and at the end. And this is a very, I think, a very good analogy. So I think that our brain can really be modeled by a force system. It just my last remark on this.
That's a great point. So,
yeah, it's called.
I'm very sorry if I could sneak in a comment there, because I find that very interesting. I think that this is also very relevant to dealing with, to throw in another big comment at the end, but to dealing with the problems of suffering, is that it seems to me that suffering, joy, and other feelings are like self-correcting mechanisms, so that what makes something worth it, like you mentioned childbirth, is whether it's good in the end. And a way to see that is it worth it, you know, at the end of the recurse, at the end of the movie? Yeah, so I do think that that is a very key way of understanding how the human brain works. I absolutely agree. I just don't know much about it, but my intuition definitely overlaps with that.
Okay.
Well, thank you for your talk. It was really good.
Yes. Thank you very much, Sandra, for taking the time to discuss your decision-making philosophy. I'm sure we'd all agree that you've given us a lot to think about before we take our next action in life. So thank you also to our panelists, to Giuseppe, Hussein, and Michael.
Yeah, I'm glad Sandra accepted our invitation. I liked how different I felt it was very different than our previous recent recordings. And I appreciate again you coming, talking, and I wish you come back and we can talk to you later on other topics as well.
Absolutely. I look forward to joining in the future.
Thank you, Sandra, for this very nice talk, and especially, you know, the way you started by the person level, the reference frame, and so on. I think it was very well structured. So I hope you can join us soon, okay?
Thank you for inviting me, and I appreciate this conversation. Great comments. I learned a lot. So I think this is worthwhile to consider every now and then. So great, magnificent way to spend a Sunday morning.
Or a Sunday evening, in my case. Yeah, thank you very much. All right, guys. Well, thanks so much, and talk to you next week.
Goodbye, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Let's make the future. Music and editing, Christian Peltonen.